four talks. The first talk is by Tomoyuki Yamakami. And
thank you. Thank you very much. Good morning, everyone. I'm the first speaker. As you see, the projector seems to have some problems, color problems. So just clicking the color in the word written here has to be written in red. So it's an assuming that this is red. So I'm going to talk about the structural complexity part of the language, common language. But before going into the details, I just give you a bit of information about the university of Fukui. So you never heard of the word Fukui before, and assuming that that is correct, so I just give you some tips. Probably in the future, so you may have a chance to come to Japan. So Japan has 47 prefectures. Prefecture is a regional unit, and Fukui prefecture is located in the somewhat the middle part of the big island. And the distance from Osaka, for example, it will take 158 train ride. If you just also look at the prefecture, it looks like a capital in the baby of the frog. And the city, the university in the city, is somewhat in the middle of the head. So this is my second chance attending TCS. I attended the TCS exactly 10 years ago. But that time, the conference was held in Toulouse, France. And I gave the, not exactly the same, but still structural complexity theory issues. And the paper was eventually published by the journal TCS. So now, we'll get back to the main theme. Today, I'm going to give structural complexity of the multi-valued partial functions, but in the framework of formal language and automata. And so in this part, I'm going to give a solution to the long-standing open problem about refinement. Don't worry about it then if you don't understand it, what the refinement is, I'm going to use the definition later on. So I start with a motivational discussion. I have been working on structural complexity theory in the framework of formal language and compound theory for years. And I, in the past, I introduced the notions like this one, bias and the pseudorandom generator, immunity, Boolean and Modulian hierarchy and CFL hierarchies. So today's talk is sort of an extension of those structural complexity issues. And first of all, I'll just give this an idea. Why we need the function instead of language? Language is the major theme in the formal language and automata theory for years. But if you look at the problems, existing problems in the real world, there are lots of different kinds of problems, for example, search problems, accounting problems, optimizing problems, etc., etc. Those problems are considered to be functions. So, it has to have values, or strings, or elements, or whatever you call it. So, and also, if you look at the polynomial type, computable setting, there are the very rich literature on the multiplied and partial NP functions. NP stands for the non-deterministic polynomial and two equations. So when you discuss the functions within the framework of formal language and automata theory, so that's the motivational discussion. So if you just we'll just think of the close look at the polynomial considering, we have so-called NP functions, and the number of function classes starting with NP, so this is a class of the multiplied and partial functions computed by polynomial time non-deterministic two equations. And the single valued version of this multiplied function is NPSE. And if you just then focus on the polar functions, so that's the standard function, close to the standard function. So this is actually what we're using the small key, the subscript key, under the MGSV. So the relation among those quite functional classes are actually, you know, something like this. The diagram showed that, you know, we the multivalued functions are obviously different from the single-valued functions. So we have obvious separation around here. And but the last one we don't know. So the FP is the function computed by a deterministic polynomial time computable 2H. And those separation between the NPSBT and FT is related to the separation between P and NP. So it's simply hard to determine to solve this problem. So now look at the CFL version of the function classes. CFL function are also known as algebraic transactions. You might make possibly encourage the algebraic transactions instead of the CFL functions. But then, you know, in comparison with NP functions, and I just keep using the CFL functions in this talk. So the functions are actually part well introduced by Abbe and Fisher in the early 1960s. So the history of the functions are very, very old. But not much discussion has been done in terms of structure problems. So now we'll focus on that particular problem. Okay, so we will start with the very fundamental the definition, push-up bundle. A push-up bundle has the stack, used as memory, and input tape that is infinite in both ends. But then the infinite string was actually surrounded by two end markers. And the head moves from left to right, possibly stopping staying still in some lines. And to compute the functions, we just say simply that pick the original machinery, we write on the output. So this is actually write on, so that you can't modify the strings, or you can't erase, or you can read the original table again. So whenever you write it, say the head has to move into the box, so now, this is non-deterministic push-down algorithm. So the computation paths are actually possibly many. And now, for example, if you just follow this computation path, and then the machine actually write down line one onto the output tape, but individually, this path might be rejected. So in that case, we simply disregard this output. And we only take the outcomes that is written on the output tape, we accept it. And those outcomes we call the valid outcomes. And we only focus on the valid output. So whenever I say output, that means the valid output in the following talk. So there might be a possibility that the whole path terminate in the rejected computation paths. In that case, the machine outputs nothing. That means the value is not defined, or output just empty sometimes. So that comes in the partial functions. And so this is more of a formal way to describe the machinery and NTE, non-dependent push-down operator, with writing on the output tape. And important thing is, I have to impose a condition, so-called termination condition. So that says that our computation path, either accepting or rejecting, it doesn't matter which you pick, but the computation path has to terminate within proportional to the input size. Why this is important? Because the CFL function has to be NP function. So that's the standard in CFL is included in NP. So that is written here. If you have the context with language, you can always take linear time MPDA. So I'm just take that as a bracket, and then put that as a condition to the function condition. So now we only have the CFL function, so we actually perform the tasks using this, these CFL functions. So, first of all, we'll introduce the CFL entry, similar to MPNP. This is the class of multi-valued partial function computed by non-deterministic Fisher parameter with half of pips. And if you just restrict the function to be single-valued, then we will get the class of CFL SV. And if you further import the condition, like in the totality, then we will get the CFL SVT. So the relationship among those complexity classes are very similar to the NP case. CFL SVT is included by CFL SV. This is included by CFL NP. And those complexity classes are properly separated. Yeah. And the interesting thing is that here is the 1F mean means, you know, this is actually a function class version of the regular languages, so to speak. So we have the separation between the non-deterministic, you know, pushdown parameter and deterministic final parameter. So separation here is also true. So this is not known for the PNP or NP function classes. So I'll give you one example. First example of the CFL function. So we'll use a notation like an R x to the R. So that means x written in reverse. So consider the reverse function. So the given input w, if w has these points, x and xr, so that's an even length polynomial, then we just simply add with the half part of x, half part of w. Otherwise, you know, the ref of w to be empty. Right? So this is the CFLSD function. Because we have a nice algorithm, so I just give you how it works in the machine base. So suppose that we have W1001, so an input, and then we non-deterministically separate or split this W into X and Y, and then put X R into stack. So that means, for example, if you have the 1, 0, the first set 2 bits, then we put the same thing in the output page, and then put that same thing into stack in the reverse order, right? And then we actually read the regs and then check whether this 0, 1 is equal to 0, 1, right? If the match does not happen, then we simply go into the rejection state. And if, you know, the 0, 1 matches the rest of the w, then we'll get into the acceptance state. So now valid output again is 1, 0, right? So this is the way that we actually compute this reverse function. Similarly, we have searching the palindrome, so that then W is given, then we find a substring that is palindrome inside this W. So this is CFL MVT, that is a total function. And for example, we have x is given, then we can find z that the inner product of the two of x and z equals to 1. Right? So this is CFL MP. Well, actually, for the IP2s, we don't need a stack. So actually, this function further goes down to the NFA MP. So this is actually a function class computed by one-way non-deterministic final parameter with output. So now, I'm going to explain the notion of refinement. So refinement is one of the most notion. First of all, as I mentioned before, you know, CFL, SVT, CFL, SV, CFL, MP, all those complexity classes are different by definition. So there is no use in talking about the inclusion, containment, you know, between among those complexity classes. Instead, we have a different notion, contain refinement. The refinement, we will use the notation like this one, so that means F is refined by G, or G is refinement of F. So that means, you know, if F of X have the valid outcome, then G of X have to have valid outcome, and vice versa. And G of X is a selection function. Somebody is selecting, you know, the sum of that value of F of X. So this refinement function is sometimes called the uniformization in some literature. We just briefly extend the functional refinement into the function class refinement. If function class F is refined by function class G, if the whole function in F is refined by some function in G. So now, I'll give you one example here. You might possibly remember that the tau, but this is actually a given W, then we can find the substring that has tau. Right? So if you just define the max tau of W to be the maximum element in this tau of W, so you just dictate the biggest element. And so this is a function, and this is a single value function. And of course, by definition, the tau, the original function, this is a multivalued function, is refined by the single value function. But the complexity of this max tau is really big. So now the question is, earlier, Constant Nidis and Santin and Liu asked the following question. Well, they decided the CFL function in the paper, and then the findings, and then asked the question. Okay. All functions belonging to the CFL MV can be possibly refined by single value functions. Right? If you look at the polynomial time scaling, so nothing is known about the refinement between NP, NP, and NPSP. Assuming that, you know, that P is equal to NP, then the refinement holds. But if you want to try to prove the non-refinement, then that means that you are actually proving that P is different from NP. Right? That really helps. Okay, so if you just go back to the history for a while, then 1960s, a long time ago, Kobayashi actually made, it's a little bit long paper. NFAMP, so the non-deterministic kind of automaton version of multivalued function. So this multivalued function is always defined by single value function. If you don't use in other words, if you don't use the stack, then you can always define the multivalued function by single value. And then the constant Nidis and Santin and Liu actually improved the Kobayashi result, showing that the point. So this circle is the functional composition. So if you first apply the CFLSP and then apply to the NFAMB, so now you get the multivalued function. This particular function of complexity class is refined by CFLSP. So this is actually the partial solution to the original question, right? This is actually the subclass of this one. So, but nothing is known until now. So I gave a complete solution to this question. So my solution is, as you see, impossibility. So the refinement doesn't work. This means not all multivalued partial CFL functions are refined by certain single-value partial CFL functions. So that is, you know, the title of this talk. So I'm going to explain the proof later on, but before that, I'll just give you some extension. I'm not really going into the detail about the polynomial time hierarchy, assuming that everybody has heard of the polynomial time hierarchy. This is the extension of the PNP polynomial. Right? And similarly, I introduced CFL hierarchy. This is the hierarchy built upon CFL and post-CFL, using tuning reduction, using non-deterministic push-up. So this is actually presented in the software. And further, we'll introduce the CFL-NP higher. So this is actually the higher to build upon CFL MV. So this result would be, this definition would be given in ICTCS inclusion in two weeks from now. So the similar is we can define it in simplified and higher. Now we will extend the original question into the bullet. So the kth level of the CFL MV can be refined by kth level of SV function. So this is the question, right? If you look at the case where the k is equal to 1, so that is exactly the same question as we solved. We are going to solve. So, but this question seems to be really hard because if they have the CFL hierarchy, so this is the language class hierarchy, crossing, then the functional hierarchy are actually somewhat crossing in terms of refinement. But we know nothing about those case levels and class in the language because this has something to do with class of the polynomial type. This is very interesting because we have a bridge between automata theory and polynomial line foundation. So now I'll give you the rough idea of how to prove the main theory. So our target is this one. So CFL MV is not refined by CFL SV. To do so, first you have to find some function that belong to CFL MV. Not defined by CFL SV. Right? So we pick one target function. So that is for H3. So that is defined in the following way. So the I3 is the set of the pairs in I and J. And I and J are integers between 1 and 3. And J is bigger than I. So we have just a few number of elements inside. So H3 is defined something like this. So if W has a form like x1, x2, x3, so we try to find out which two of them are actually mirror images. And then we just simply put them the numbers here. I just did just the example here. If you have 1, 0, 0, 1, 1, 1, 1 0 and 0, 1 are actually the mirror images. So the outcome is that 1, 0 and 2, 1, 0. And if you have 1, 0, 1, 0, 0, 1, we have two possible pairs. 1, 0, and 0, 1, and 1, 0, and 0, 1. So we have 1, 0, 2, 1, 2, 0, 3, 1. Right? And we'll give you a rough idea of that. Why is F3 belong to the CFL and B? The algorithm is very simple. We just create check whether the W has this form using just the standard and the determinism kind of algorithm. In the simultaneously, we check the following thing. First, we guess the pair I and J, and then we write down the corresponding letter onto an pick, and then check I X is actually is the mirror image of the J X. And if it is correct, then going to an accepted state, and otherwise rejected state. Okay. So this shows that H3 is in CFL MV. Now we have to show that the most important part of the truth. H3 is not refinable by any single value functions. To do so, first we have to think about the non-determinism pushdown parameter having an output page. But then the analysis of the output it's not that easy as you think. So we try to get rid of this output pick. So I kind of invented a new machinery called the colored automaton. So now this colored automaton has no output pick, but all stack symbol has colors. So that's why I call this machine the colored automaton. And if the color C is used in this particular computation path, and we call it C computation path. And then this machinery has no output, but then a computing function. So we have to invent how this machine outputs out of the state. So the output is defined in the molecule. If the particular accepting path has color, all stack symbols using the same color, then this is considered to be an output. So now the claim is the following. If you take any function, a CFLMD function, then you can always find colored automaton that compute the same function. If the function has output from the fixed string set, because the total number of the colors are fixed, so we can't output more than a fixed number of elements. So that's the catch. But then for H3A, this is enough. So now that this is outlined, the proof proceeds by contradiction. So we assume that this is not the case. That means we can always find refinement in the CFL-SB of H3. So now this is a CFL-SB function. So we have a non-determinate pushdown automaton that computes this function G with output. So now we convert this machinery into a colored machine. So there is no output. And we will go into the, I'm not going to the detail about names, but we just analyze the stack behavior. So we call it stack history. Then we will find that there is a contradiction. So why we get the contradiction? Because we assume that it is strong, right? So the G does not exist. So that's the end of the truth. For future challenges, I pick up the three questions. First one is the, as I mentioned before, will we extend the, our non-refinement result into a higher level? Right? And CFL, CFL MD is not refined by K-level CFL SB for any K. But it seems to be really hard. And also, it's nice to find the calculation of the refinable part of the CFL MD. So we have to really analyze it, what kind of property, what kind of structure property, the whole thing is happening. And also, extending that, maybe we can find more interesting properties, closure properties, structural properties, and a whole bunch of different properties. Okay, thank you. Thank you very much for listening, and I'll take your questions.
Are there any questions, comments?
Yes.
You mentioned that if you take a single value to select function, mm-hmm. and then you do a multi-value NFA function, mm-hmm. then you can define it. What if you first take the NFA function and then the single value?
You're talking about refinement?
Yes.
Because the single value is multivalued function by definition, right?
Yeah, but if you first do a multivalued NFA function and you compose it with a single value push down another function.
Not really following your question, but
in the slide you have the function result about the composition.
Mm-hmm. Oh, I see, okay. This one, right?
Yes. So what if you...
Yeah, this one.
What if you compose the other way around?
Oh, I see, okay. I have no idea. But if you have the NF, could be the same as, I'm not sure, okay? But then my guess is that if you just replace the NF than those two, you could possibly get to see the NF.
That's with high probability. You can, but well, there is a problem. Are there any question or comment? I have a question about your search for the refined class. Mm-hmm. So have you tried to, there is a classical subclass of what you call CFL and the which was called algebraical rational transduction. And I think it was defined by Fries in the 70s.
Yeah, but then Fries is the Nash.
And so this is a strict subclass of CFL and V. And maybe you can look at this function without. And they behave much nicer with the general CFL and V.
Oh, that's okay. Well, thank you very much.
So you have not applied?
No.
Okay, other comments? Well, if not, we thank our speakers.